We've all seen electric cars. Have you seen electric NASCARs?
Dude, so I got to go to a NASCAR race recently. I went to the Phoenix Championship. ABB had this all-electric EV prototype NASCAR race car. And I was like, how does this even work? You don't even have a motor in the car. And then I got to thinking about like how fast EVs are. And the reason that they're so fast has to do with the motors. So rather than a huge combustion engine in the front of these things, there are three six-phase motors on three of the wheels that are producing power instantaneously from a battery. So that changes a lot about racing. So let's talk a little bit about six-phase and what six-phase does and why there's benefits to it. So to understand why six-phase is so awesome, we kind of need to understand why single-phase and three-phase is less awesome. If we have a single-phase system, what we have is a pulsing power supply. That means that 60 times a second, we're changing directions. And every time we change directions, because the windings are set 180 degrees apart from each other inside of a generator, we have these points where there is zero power being transferred. And if it's pulsing 60 times a second, it means that there's no power being transferred at this node 60 times a second also. So it's just less efficient. So we came out with a three-phase system. Three-phase system, you'll notice that there's no point where there's a zero node like this. You will have little minimums like this, and then you'll have maximums like this. So there is kind of a fluctuation that happens with three phase, but it's a really efficient way to produce a lot of power, which is why in industrial and commercial environments, we use three phase power. So six phase power is basically taking that idea and expanding on it even more. So there's six phases happening here. There's almost no difference between the maximums and the minimums between any two phases. So it is just cramming power super, super efficient rather than having any kind of pulsing where you're gonna have any inefficiency happen. So if we look at the windings specifically, three phase windings, six phase windings, the only thing that's different is that you take three of these and you add three more and you turn them like that. So we've got a 60 degree separation between any two windings, whereas in three phase, we have a 120 degree difference between each one of the windings. Now, what's really important with motors, especially synchronous motors like we have, synchronous just means that we have a rotating magnetic field. Every time one of these bumps, it creates a field that's rotating. Inside of here, the rotor is trying to synchronize. So the thing that's making the rotor spin are these magnetic fields spinning. With a synchronous motor, that synchronous motor actually, or the rotor itself, has to synchronize. It has to get to the same speed and keep up with the rotating magnetic field. So at first, it doesn't do that really well. There's a little bit of a flutter in the torque curve. So every motor is gonna have some kind of a torque curve to get the thing started. Well, with a six phase motor, there's less separation between there. You have a solidly rotating magnetic field. So it's easier for a synchronous motor to synchronize faster. So it actually has a better torque curve than a traditional three phase motor. There's also just the form factor, the amount of power that you can get in the same form factor. You don't have to increase the size of a motor that's six phase. You just add more phases to it. So you can get more power produced, like I was showing those sine waves earlier, in the same form factor, in a smaller form factor. You also have just more efficiency in general. Now you have six windings, so to run current through all the conductors, you have more conductors that you're running current through, so it's a little bit more efficient. You don't have as much heating on only three conductors, you're spreading it over six. Then we have fault tolerance. So what happens in a three-phase environment when you lose a phase is it sucks to try to run a motor, right? We're synchronizing motion, and to do that efficiently, to get that motor to spin efficiently, we need this even separation. So if we lose one, it's dramatic for that motor to try to keep going on only two phases. Well, when you have more phases, if you lose one, you still have five more phases that are helping that thing keep rotation. So it has inherent fault tolerance already built into the design of it. And then we've got harmonic distortion. So harmonic distortion is decreased when you have windings that are so close to each other versus a three-phase system like this. So all of these things are much better, and it kind of like begs the question, why in the US don't we just have six-phase power? And the answer is because we've been doing it since old school and now it's too expensive. Can you imagine the entire power grid, every utility company's generators inside that are generating power, all of the towers and poles that are carrying three conductors that are designed specifically to carry the weight of only these three conductors. We'd have to replace every single one of them. Every transformer, there's probably millions and millions of transformers around the US, both up on utility poles, on ground. To get a six-phase system put in, it's not just about producing six-phase, it's about receiving six-phase. So all these industrial facilities that have three-phase motors would have to change to six-phase motors. So you can kind of see, like, there's no way possible that we would ever be able to change over to six-phase power. But in an application like an EV, six-phase is perfect for these cars. Now, another thing that I think is really cool about these motors and EVs in general is that most of them operate on regenerative braking, which means that the vehicle kind of naturally slows itself. If any of you have ever driven an EV out there, you realize when you let off the gas, it starts to slow. And that kinetic energy is getting transferred back into the battery and is charging the battery. So it actually changes the dynamics for a race car driver too, for how they're braking around corners.
For me as a driver, to have the adjustability, when you have the instant power, you've got the capability to change torque around, the regeneration, and it adds another layer of strategy. You know, how much power do you want initially, but how long do you want to run? And there's a threshold that the engineers have to work on that perfect formula. But even as a driver, I feel like I could have an influence on the speed versus how long I'm running. So, you know, again, this is such a new project that we're still learning every time we're at the racetrack.
Then when you look in the engine bay and you realize there's no engine, but you see cooling systems, that got me like, why do you have cooling systems if you don't have this engine that you're running coolant through to try to cool the motor? What's the point of the cooling systems?
Brandon, it's nice to meet you. So you have helped with the engineering of this beast right here. And I saw some of the things on that wall, like, you know, the battery capacity, the voltage, all the DC. What I'm really curious about is the cooling specifically. So I know the traditional motor, you have combustion and you're cooling. Are you trying to cool the battery or the motors?
So we're cooling both, right? Mainly the battery. So the car actually has a stacked set of radiators in it. So a front and a rear. The front radiator is cooling the battery. So it's liquid cooled, right? A little electric pump in here as soon as we power up the car, pumping fluid through. And the main reason for that is when you go into a corner and start the regen cycle of you basically collect the kinetic energy and you know, pumping that back into the battery, that is an extremely fast charge rate.
Oh, okay.
So faster than the charge rate of charging the vehicle stationary, getting ready to go. So that amount of energy being input into the battery pack, you have to be able to cool that. So yeah, that's our main reason for cooling on the car.
Okay.
Then I found out that just the torque alone to the wheels of this car, because of the instantaneous motors, battery, all of that, the torque characteristics on the tires means that the tires have to be designed differently.
So we're working on developing intelligent tires, tires that have sensors embedded in the tire to communicate to the car and control systems and then driver even. In this case, tire pressure and also temperature of the cavity and the surface of the inside of the tire.
You're telling me that the tires are talking to the car.
Exactly. Yes, it's a...
That's actually mind-boggling. I'm sorry.
Can you hear them? They might be talking right
now. What language do they speak? What coder is it?
Is it just one sensor, or are there like multiple sensors all throughout?
One sensor in each tire. And this is a technology that we introduced in the Garage 56 project with NASCAR at Le Mans last year. And this is just the latest generation of that. It's about 75% lighter than the system that we had in that car just a little over a year ago. We started with the basic NASCAR cup tire construction, and then we've also incorporated some more sustainable materials. So that's something that we're looking at as a test bed.
Okay.
And this,
the EV thing, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So is there any, like, you said it's more sustainable materials, but do you have to have thicker material or anything to handle that torque, or what's...
No, it's similar gauges to what we have on the cup car, but it's the way we do the layups of the materials and then the strength of the actual materials that are in the tire itself.
Okay. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Yeah. Riley, it is so nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Dustin.
So I'm told that you're the person I'm supposed to talk about why there's a 35 on that electric car.
The 35, yeah. So the 35 on the ABB NASCAR EV prototype is a nod to our company goal of net zero operating emissions by 2035. So NASCAR owns 15 racetracks across the country, including this one, including Phoenix. And we, as a company, last year set a goal to reduce our, to basically decarbonize our racetracks, our facilities, and everything that we own within this space. And so the 35 is a nod to that goal. And really a big part of that is electrifying a lot of our assets. So okay, focusing on electricity in the buildings and then introducing more EVs into our fleet.
So that seems like a monster mission, though. Like, as big of a scale of operations that you guys have and the number of tracks and everything, do you think it's possible in 10 years?
I think with partners like ABB on board, where we have a lot of support, then I think it's possible. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
So that was pretty awesome. It was a cool experience to get to experience. Obviously, EVs are moving, globally, we're electrifying. So like, there's EV stuff going on everywhere. We actually have some courses and videos and things on EVs charging. So if you're looking for a little bit more information, you should check out the Electrician U learning system. Just go to electricianu.com. There is a link in the description below. Love you, crazy people. I'll see you in the next one.